If in the audience anybody would like to ask any questions, can raise your hands, we'll pass on the mics.
Go ahead.
Of course, you talked about the day-to-day application of science. Other than that, how will I bring innovation attitude in schools of India, government schools, primarily schools of India?
You know, one thing that I have realized is that we organize idea competition in during our shodhyatras and the schools, and we only ask two questions. Look for something that you need but don't have. Second, find out inadequacy in what you have. That's it. Very simple. No big technique, no big method. And the moment children start thinking of inadequacy in what they have, they come out with ideas like this. So one child in Arunachal Pradesh mentioned something that I should have known. I feel so bad about myself that I didn't realize this for such a long time. But that only shows how much distance I have to travel as children rather than our society. You know, this pounding of paddy, to thrash it, get the grain out. So women have this vessel, a plucker cut and down, and there's a bowl. And they make it for wheat grains. This girl said, we asked the simple question, find out all the problems that bother your mother, and for which there's no solution. So the kid said, look, when my mother does it, she gets blisters here. Can you design a glove with a little sponge in it, so that she will not get blisters here? Now, she's not asking too much. She's not asking for too much. By this time, our country should have had this. Isn't it? We can't give her anything else, but at least we can reduce her pain. There's no reason why she should suffer. Like that, the unmet needs come out so quickly with a suggestion. She's not just articulating a problem, she's also suggesting a solution. A glove which has a little sponge in it. And a good glove. So these kids in a village of Arunachal Pradesh, far off from the mainstream, can think of solution. What did I do? We just merely triggered. So my suggestion is, whenever we have an opportunity, and I'm going to spend my next 10, 20 years with children, as you were mentioning, we should at least unleash their imaginative power to come out with all the ideas that they have. And then our job is to convert that into reality and get those gloves in the hands of those district children and make them rely on their ideas and make a difference. Yes, please.
Sir, I have a question, sir. How do we make our ideas different from other?
First of all, it's a good question. What's your name? Aapka naam kya?
Myself is Priyaranjan Kumar.
Priyaranjan, many times what happens that when ideas come to us, they might be similar to what others have thought. Don't feel too bad about it. All of us will have this situation. So what we do is normally we do a background search. Just to find out whether somebody else has invented that before. And if so, can I do it at lesser cost? Can I do it in a more easy way? Can I make it open source because other person might have patent on it or whatever? So doing a proper simple search will help me to find out whether that idea is helpful or not. But even if somebody has developed it, and if you can do it at lesser cost and in much greater ease, don't hesitate. So don't let the Columbus and Nehru killed the idea. You know, Columbus' formula was wrong actually. If you had not formed the US, you would have died in the sea. The calculation of distance was wrong. But we can sometimes overcome our desire to be first and don't mind being second or third, so long as we can make that solution accessible to people. Yes.
Sir, when we talk about innovations, many times typical MBA or that's likely to other corporates, innovation equals kind of to commercialization and scale up. ये जो दो word है commercialization होना है या scale up ही होना है उसमें आपका क्या है?
First of all, I am a strong believer that scale should not become the enemy of sustainability. There are a large number of niches in our country where solution will not diffuse very widely because that problem is not very widely felt. For instance, we were in Dhimaji district of Assam and Shoyantane. Now water there has high iron content. No company will manufacture a filter which will only sell to about 10,000 people. So what should that people do? They should remain remain deprived of a technology which they already have, which is not good enough. Or should we develop solution where it will only scale up to 10,000 pieces and not more than that? So let us not use the mantra of scale to deny people access to what they deserve. But often cannot desire. Because that scale is, this was a problem when manufacturing model was of the yesterday. The future manufacturing model with 3D printing and whatever have you can democratize manufacturing at small scale of the same quality and the same efficiency as the larger scale manufacturing was. So there's a big change that is going to happen in the manufacturing system in the country, in the world. We are going to have what Gandhian concept was of decentralized manufacturing. At long last, that's going to happen. And if that is going to happen, then we can meet a small scale. Correct? Second question about open source or commercialization. I have no problem with commercialization. All of us buy things. My only question is, how many things do we buy or did we buy last week made by people who work with their hands? That question bothers me. Because people work with their hands, craftsmen, artisan, weavers. Hum toh khadi nahi khareedte. Hum log tum toh banaye hue cheeze nahi khareedte. So money from my pocket doesn't go to those who work with their hands. And this is the dilemma. I would appeal to every friend of mine, not because I like khadi, but do buy something which is made by hands, by people. Every week, something. Food, of course you will buy, but clothes, things, paper, whatever. Buy something that is made by hand every week. And that way you are doing minimum that you should do, which is transferring the purchasing power that you have in the hands of those who work with their hands, who still keep the connection between the soil and the soul. So, yes, I don't have any problem with the commercialization so long as we can direct it in a manner that it can connect the consumers with the producers who work with their soul in it. Yes, please.
You made a very interesting point that, you know, now is the time for collaborations because knowledge will start to get distributed. But I'm just very eager to know from your experiences, you know, what have you seen as just good insights on how collaborations can be nurtured, facilitated, because collaborations is the place where you come in with, you know, your proprietorship, your insecurities, your ownership. So, we'd love to hear.
What's your name?
My name is Manisha
Gupta. Manisha, it's a good question. And thank you for asking this question because that gives me an opportunity to answer with empirical data. National Innovation Foundation had very little budget. For first 10 years, the budget was 8% interest on 30 crore, which is 1.6 crore. And we have a huge database. So we had to be frugal and we had to provide it. So let me share a few examples. So first thing we did was, we told the IP company, international property companies, because we wanted to file patents for the transaction companies. We said, we can't give you payment in financial currency. Do you want payment in currency of joy and happiness? And they fell for it. So we have filed 800 patents. 800. Eight of them granted in US. And our average cost is rupees as against 150,000, that would be minimum cost that a company will charge. Minimum, maybe 250,000 for Indian people. And 15 lakhs, then 15 lakhs for US people. We don't pay a single penny. So the ethical capital and the social capital can be converted into financial capital. We every year work with 200 labs for validation of people's knowledge, traditional knowledge or contemporary knowledge, a veterinary scientist. Human research, health researchers, agricultural scientists, agriculture engineers, so on. None of them charge for the time. So our average cost of validation is about 2.5 lakh, which is will be easily 25 lakhs with the proposal was they come to DST. What I'm trying to say is collaboration works. It works at a very large scale. It works in a durable manner. It works in India. You know, we say India is not a very collaborative society. Who says that? Honeybee network provides the evidence, sufficient evidence. More than 120,000 ideas from 550 districts of our country, 90% of them have been sought out by volunteers. Only 10% came to us on their own. Why would these people do this without any payment? Because they believe that this idea is viable. It will give visibility, voice and velocity to people. So collaboration is the only way to go. There is no other way. We couldn't have done what we have done, and we cannot do it future either. I cannot reach 70,000 people whom they are treating every year otherwise without collaboration. Tell me, is there any better way? I can't do that. I can't reach the people who travel in the rickshaw, but I need to reach them. I can't reach the people who are carrying coal yesterday. I have to work with somebody here, isn't it? Who will give this statue to all the people who are carrying coal. Like, kaise pahuncha unke paas? We don't want to expand. I need to scale up the size of the NIF. No. Because that money, which I will spend in scaling up, better go to people. So we have ensured that through collaboration, we also remain frugal. We also remain extremely affordable. And joy, more than that, happiness and the joy that people have in working together is so good, so wonderful, so that there is no way in which I can bury that joy. So please don't think this is only an academic issue. It's a real bread and butter issue. Without collaboration, we can't make our society out of the morass of mediocrity. There is no way. There is just no way. And I think what Madhavar is doing in this conference, Father, this is a wonderful, I need to congratulate you for that, to provide such a platform that this could become a collaboration lab, cooperation lab forever, because the exact details of what Manisha is asking may need to be worked out. And many people may not have an idea as to how to work out those agreements. So maybe you need to have a small legal cell to work out agreements. Very simple, no frill agreements with no mutual liability and so on. You know, there are easy ways of coming to an arrangement, institutional arrangement, so that the interest of each party is protected. No liabilities. So for example, we indemnify every collaborator from any liability that may arise on account of something that we have developed in the collaboration, which may or may not work properly. So for example, if a designer works with us and there's a design machine that he has done, and tomorrow if it is causing some injury, we don't want that designer to suffer. We indemnify them. So simple clauses, indemnification clauses, will make the agreement much more acceptable. And people will say, well, there's no liability in this then. I can work with you. So there are institutional aspects which I think institutions like XLRI have to bring in, because this is a skill that is not everybody knows, that one clause can make so much difference to the potential for collaboration. So we indemnify everybody. Indian Council of Medical Research, Council of Scientific Industrial Research, and Indian Council of Agricultural Research, all the three which we have MOU with, they are indemnified. Even CSI, because if their lab does something for us, and we have not used it properly, or we have misinterpreted, or misused, or misapplied, it is not they who should be faulted. We don't want to make them. One last point. I mentioned about patents. I didn't tell you that we also have a concept of technology commons. Technology commons means people-to-people copying is not only allowed but encouraged. People-to-firm through licensing. We have put the IP law on its head. People-to-people copying is allowed and encouraged. We have decided nobody for whom we file the patent will ever file a suit against another person who works with hands or some other project. Never. No way. Not possible. Because we don't want our society to become an integrated society. It's all right for America to do that. Now the difference is, if you look at Chinese Politburo, 99% are engineers and 1% only is legal. In US the other way around. It is the legal people who rule the country and govern that society. We don't want to get to go to the US way, no. So please understand that we have developed models. And I mentioned Technology Commons is one, there's another GTIF, Grassroots Technological Innovation Acquisition Fund. We create the property rights and then we buy them to make them available at no cost or no cost, creating open access. There are 70 technologies available at NIF website, NIF India.org. Anybody can use them, no need for permission. 15,000 innovations and technology practices are available at sushti.org in open source, large number of them in 4 languages. Use them. No permission required. Our dream is India should become the largest provider of open source solutions for survival. That's what our dream is. India must become the largest provider of open source solutions for people. Because today, if you go to net and look for innovations, and many of you must do that, you wouldn't find any database of this kind of definition. Why? With billions of dollars going in developmental funding, why should it be so difficult to find even 500 solutions in public domain? For drinking water and for whatever problem we have? But this is amazing. This is just amazing. No conscience. People can't realize that they are using billions of dollars, all kinds of developmental aid, and yet the library, the open source solutions are so scanty. No accountability. So I think we need to ask this question very quickly. How do we do that? But thanks for asking this question. Good question. Yes, please. The last one. Last one. Yes. Yeah. Time you decide what time you have. I have no problem. Yes, please.
Sir, we learn social innovations are the need for the day, but in order to solve the diversified problems of the country, but as we are learning, there are many more innovations which is happening, but that's not getting into the eye of many more people. Might be prototypes are not getting done, or it's not reaching to the scale. So what is your suggestions to deal with these kind of issues?
Can I ask the bhai?
Madhuban Pandey.
मधुबन जी, ऐसा है कि अभी मैंने एक कॉलम लिखा है, वो आज ये पत्र आ जाएगा टेक्नोलॉजी की वेबसाइट पर. व्हाट आई वांट टू डू दैट इज 10,000 करोड़ दैट फंड दैट कमर्स गैस रेटेड एंड इज गोइंग टू इन्वेस्ट वेंचर कैपिटल फंड्स. वेंचर कैपिटल फंड्स आर नॉट नोन टू इन्वेस्ट इन अर्ली स्टेज आइडियाज, नेवर, नो वे. सो देयरफॉर आई एम आस्किंग दैट इज नॉट द राइट थिंग. वी हैड गेटेड व्हेन 13th फाइनेंस कमीशन वाज चेयर्ड बाय डॉक्टर केलकर. आई रिटन द नोट फॉर दैट. We created a district innovation fund of 1 crore in every district. Didn't work very well because people were not there, but I'm asking for 5 crore fund for every district in the country so that within the local community you can access an idea, within a month you make a decision, deliver the resources, person should be able to work. We created in 2003 called a micro venture innovation fund. There are many friends here who work with microfinance. Have you heard about micro venture finance? No. Neither has World Bank heard about it, nor has Asian Development Bank heard about it, nor Latin American Development Bank heard about it. No financial institution has heard about it. Why? Because they don't realize if risk capital is so critical for biotechnology, for information technology, for other fields of transformation, why would it be necessary for grassroots innovations, for more social innovations? It will be now, isn't it? So we need to have more micro venture innovation fund. We financed, with the help of SIDBI, 192. People around the country, single signature, no guarantee, no collateral, 80% money came back. These small entrepreneurs have a tremendous ethical capital. We have proved it. 4 crore rupees, 3.8 came back. So what I am trying to say, it's a proven model. We need to give risk capital. What we are asking for is a risk capital to ideas, whether it is service models, or technological models, or institutional models, so that they can learn to fail. Of course, many will fail, but that's the investment we make in their education, in their learning, in the societal learning. We will all learn from that. So the idea is, and I would also appeal to those of us who have high net worth individuals. You know, you came from corporate career, you must have made some savings. You know, we should put our money where our mouth is. So three of us created a small social innovation fund, SIF.sachi.org. We put 22 lakh rupees there. First line of investment is grant, no money. So one student, four students of which Binani developed and a device attachable to my cell phone, which will take an image of a blood drop, identify with 75% accuracy whether malaria is there or not. We invested. We asked how much money do you need? Said 20,000. I said take 25,000. Make second prototype. It's available at the website, SIF.sachi.org. I think we need to, I would appeal to all my friends here, be investor, angel investor, early stage finance. Take some small ideas around you, invest in it. Small amount, but you decide whatever amount in a year you want to invest. 50,000 rupees, 1 lakh rupees a year. Give it to 4 people, 5 people, 6 people, whatever amount. But invest a small amount of money in the ideas of people who like. No permission, nobody's permission required. But we must make it easier for young people to try things out. And they don't have to struggle to go to institutions and banks and whatever have you. the ecosystem like this, and I will agree that one of the things that should come out of this conference is a small social innovation fund. Let us trigger that. Maybe you should house it and create a small fund where people can voluntarily contribute. And they can, they will, every investment is on the website. So all the investments, 192 investments are on NIF or by NIF on the website. So everything is transparent. You know which money was paid back, which was not paid back, where was it given, to whom it was given, and for what purpose was it given. Everything is transparent. Where is the problem then? So the question is, you are right, we need to provide such support. But I don't want to wait till the government rises to the occasion. I think we should do it at our own level. Whatever. Yes. But you could manage the time, man. I'm ready, but you should manage the time. Whenever you want me to stop, I'll stop. Yes, please. Go ahead. After this.
Sir, my name is Shantanu Bhattacharji. You know, I wonder, these grassroots innovators actually do manage to get advantage of the various policy initiatives in the context of government India or any other government departments in the country. And if not, what can be done to so that they can actually get the, you know, take advantage of these initiatives. You know, for example, Mudra Yojana or Startup India, etc.
Shantanu, I would say that yes, policy initiatives are very important. They must be changed. We didn't wait for that. When NIF was created, we didn't wait for policy initiative. We just did it. We went, talked to the people, 6 months, we take a secretary to pass guide. उनसे बोला भाई हमने ये काम किया है इसको आगे बढ़ाना है क्या आपको यस ऑफकोर्स दे ऑफर्ड अ प्रोजेक्ट आई सेड आई डोंट वांट अ प्रोजेक्ट फ्रॉम यू वी वांट सम इंस्टीट्यूशनल इनिशिएटिव सो इन 98 दिसंबर आई वाज टॉकिंग टू वन ऑफ द सेक्रेटरीज इन एग्रीकल्चर डिपार्टमेंट एंड सेड यू नो अनिल यू हैव ऑलरेडी मेट 5 मिनिस्ट्रीज नथिंग इज हैपनिंग व्हाई डोंट यू मीट अ पर्सन इन मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ फाइनेंस दैट फेलो इज पीएचडी इन फिजिक्स ही माइट अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट यू आर टॉकिंग सो आई वेंट टू मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ फाइनेंस टॉक टू दिस सेक्रेटरी पीएस शर्मा ही वाज Secretary General Expenditure. He talked to Vijay Kelkar, who was Secretary of Finance. They talked to Ashwin Sinha from this region, who was Finance Minister. And eventually this happened. What I'd like to say is, I don't think we will ever get a policy response for the idea that we adopted here in this region. We'll have to go and create a space for that policy. One advice that I will give, and you will kindly make it aware, make it known to everybody who takes your classes. Social entrepreneurs should not expect governments and ministries to change their policies to expand their businesses. They are not in that business to create market for their goods and services. But we need that still. So what do? We have to struggle and appeal, and appeal, and appeal. One person will not respond, two will not respond, three will not respond. I am an indefatigable optimist. Matha Kabir, I don't give up. Because I know that somebody in the chain will have the right one. There is always a person in the chain, in the robotic system, who has his or her heart in the right place. We have to find that person. That's the only thing I can tell you. There's no easy way. We wrote to all the member of parliament. They have this MP large scheme, right? Yeah. 2 crore rupees. I said, please allocate 1 lakh rupees out of your scheme for the innovators in your constituency. Main kuch nahi maang raha hoon aapse. Nahi ho paya. Manmohan Singh wrote to somebody. I wrote again to the Prime Minister. Again, it has not happened so far, so what, am I going to give up? No. That process can also continue. And at the same time, we should continue at our level, look for civil society initiatives, look for those bureaucrats who are sympathetic to what we are talking about, and pursue. But please don't expect policymakers to send you an invitation card and please come and talk to me. There are some people like that who might do it. But more often than not, it takes a long struggle. It takes a long time. We still don't have a national micro venture innovation fund. How long have we been trying? 1997. First time we proposed the idea. It has not become institutionalized as yet. But would I give up? No. I'm sure our president has said that microfinance met the need of those products and services for which market existed. Micro venture finance is for those goods and services for which market does not exist. Very obvious. Simple, isn't it? Doesn't require a great deal of complexity to understand this message. And yet, this message is not gone home, neither by the previous government nor by the current government. Doesn't matter. We'll continue trying. I'll keep writing about it. Until that happens, we will create fund the problem. That's what I'm saying. Please, in policy initiatives, one thing which often works is an action example, a kind of a pilot or a demonstration of something that you believe in. And that often convinces people more than any amount of logical argument or a good discussion paper. Policies don't change because of research papers, generally, not as many times. But they do change when we do action research. So action research is the way to go, I would put it this way. And we might be able to make some change. Yes, sir.
I wonder whether this question of mine would fit in into the scheme of things that you are sharing. But before that, audience, I would request you. I am Sharad Sarin. I am teaching in XLRI for the last 40 years. So please also join me in applauding Anil's excellent talk. Thank you very much. Now my question is, 600 million people deprived of sanitation. In your Shodh Yatras, did you come across any solutions which would have sanitation without water or with very low use of water?
Actually, I wrote a small piece on that recently and tweeted it to Prime Minister. When the study came out and said that large number of toilets that have been built are not being used for the purpose for which they were built. In my own village, that happened. My father got that built. And people converted them into a storehouse. So my suggestion was very simple. Build roofless toilet in the field. Problem is solved. Roofless toilets in the field. So there are two purposes served. Manure for the crop. And no roof, so no storage. Simple solution. Don't build toilet with this roof. Apne umbrella leke jao barish aa rahi hai. You understand? Sometimes we have to coerce people into understanding. Optimal coercion is not zero, as they say. So we need to work out solutions that would provide answer. And people then will put a roof of their own if they want. But please understand that there is a close connection between human excreta and waste and fertilization of soil. And I don't think I want to break that link. So I am saying, can we find a good way? You still go to their place, but don't ship in open ground. There's a big latrine, put some soil on it, reasonably good. In Northeast, you know, there are deep pit latrines, some 20 feet down deep. On the first floor, they will build it. If a house is there, they will build the toilet on the first floor, and the pit is on the ground floor. So there are a large number of models that exist actually, which are reasonably odorless and flyless, because there's always a pool of sand that is lying in the toilet. Take a spade, hoe, and put that soil on the waste so that cover it, so no flies come, no mosquitoes, nothing. Hygienically. So no water is required. In fact, there's a lot of research required on the physics of the pan, the pot, because ideally we don't have 15 liters of water to flow down that waste. So therefore, the design that we're using are completely unfit. One good innovation that has happened is biodigester. So what happened? Some scientists went to Antarctica and they found that the excreta of penguin was not visible. So they wondered what happens to the excreta of the penguin. Was there a penguin among them? So essentially one of the Indian scientists figured out that actually degrades very fast. Now we have a problem with Siachen. They were also linked to the defense. So while they developed a solution for Siachen, which is the highest battlefield, but they also found a solution that this organism that they found from the waste of a penguin was brought to the mainland, did research. Now in railways you have biodigester toilets, which in real time digest the waste and remove the problem of E. coli spreading all over the country. Railways are the greatest spreader of E. coli infection in this country. Greatest spreader. One single agency which has spread the E. coli infection in this country is railways. Because human toilet waste gets spread on the railway lines, and then rain comes and it goes into the water bodies. And 60% disease in our country, anywhere, waterborne. So there's a close connection between the way we are systematically and institutionally spreading the infectious load in this country. It's an amazing country. I mean, it's an amazing country. But sometimes I wonder why it is so difficult for us to understand the source of the problem. So, yeah, but our solution is not in having water based toilet, because we won't. We don't like drinking water, so what's the question about it? Why important? But deep wind latrines are safe, odorless, flightless. And that's a good answer.
Hello, sir.
I'm not close, sir. Anybody who has not spoken, because you have already spoken, yes. So somebody who has not spoken, if any. Yeah, please.
So I'm sure you're aware IIT Delhi, when you walk into the main admin block and you go to their washroom, they have waterless urinal. Now, why can't we find those technologies? I'm sure there are hundreds of them somewhere and capitalize on them. What is holding, where in the system is it holding it back?
You know what, I'm going to be very candid and self-critical. I come from an institute, one of the top institutes of our country and the world. If I calculate the amount of water that I recycle in my institute, very low. The water that we use in our lawns is the same water that we use for drinking. I'm just telling you the degree of the culpability of mine in the crime that I'm committing as a member of that committee, because I'm dealing with it. Though I protest, but my protest has not yet worked. And I'm being very candid because I want to criticize myself and our institution so that we have more courage to do that in more and more places. Unless we do that, there's no authenticity to what I'm saying. So once I propose in my column that all public institutions and private institutions must be obliged to share on the wall outside, for example, XLRI wall outside, how much of water is recycled, how much of rooftop water is stored, how much of water footprint I'm using for my toilets and other purposes which is not recyclable. This is an accountability each one of us should have and put it in public domain outside the wall so that every person of this country should know how responsible and responsive I am to the need that country is facing. There's no other way. There's no other way. So every public and private institution must be obliged to disclose these requirements. Today the situation is very, very bad. The kitchen water, the bathroom water, which is a good quality water, can easily be filtered and reused, is not being done. So one-time cost of putting those pipes, for separate drainage pipes, because that cost is there, will pay back actually. There's a very interesting experiment which happened in Bhabra plant of Tata Chemicals. Very interesting. We are in Jamshedpur, so I should mention to you. We were doing some research on innovations also in corporate sector. This came up in that. They had a dilemma. They had in the coastal area. So a lot of saline water is available. They asked the question, if we use saline water for toilet, the corrosion will take place, so we'll have to replace the pipe after a particular time. What is the cost of that? And what is the cost of drinking water? It came up, turned out that replacing pipe was cheaper than filtering water. So they use saline water. The entire campus of their plant, they use sea water for toilet purposes. Simple answer. So there are answers available. There are answers available. And I think, Madhukar, you have to do this here. Make a good database, open source database. Every student sitting here must make 100 entries of open source solutions in public services, in private systems, on just water and sanitation. Let us create the country's largest database of solutions from around the world on water and sanitation and XLRI. This is something that must happen. Because this is what you're asking for. This is what you're asking for. Your question has triggered this need. And unless we do this labor of love, it will not happen. But I can assure you there are solutions available. As you mentioned, as I mentioned to you. And these trade-offs, somehow we don't think about. Why should I filter water for need for which I don't have to? If I have to drain the mug, why should I use filtered water? Why should I use clean water? Why can't I use saline water? Or low quality water. So therefore, there is a need for us to think along that line and solve these problems. But these problems are solvable. As you can see in every question, my response always is, we can find a way out. And I think we can find it. Thank you so much.
Director to present the memento and felicitate Sir Anil Gupta.
is happening.